Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Ankita Jain. I'm a periodontist and implantologist, currently working as a full-time practitioner. I was remembering my BDS days where we used to study a lot of subjects and find it very difficult to make notes on each and every important topic. In fact, if we make notes also, they seem to be a little insufficient. So this is my attempt to help my those friends and students who actually get lost in different subjects. My this video and in my upcoming videos, I will be sharing my notes and there will be the compilation of material from different sources which will cover your major textbook, other standard books and the articles from relevant journals. These notes will be in the form of flowcharts, self-explanatory diagrams and the line diagrams which will be easy to remember and you can easily reproduce them in the examinations. At the end, there will be a question bank which will help you to self-evaluate about the topic. At last, if you have any query, any doubt, or you want any kind of detailed material on a particular topic, or you want any topic to be taken on priority, then kindly email me on my email ID or leave your suggestions in the comment section below. If you like this initiative of mine and find this video useful, then kindly like, share and subscribe. Thank you.
So, hello everyone. Today we will be discussing gingivectomy. Let's begin with the headings under which this topic will be discussed. Headings will include introduction and definition, indications and contraindications, types of gingivectomy in which four types will be discussed, that is surgical gingivectomy, gingivectomy by electrosurgery, laser gingivectomy by chemosurgery, and failures of gingivectomy will be discussed. Then gingivoplasty along with the references. Let's first begin with the introduction and definition. Now this definition we can split into three parts, that is excision of gingiva, visibility and accessibility, and for complete calculus removal and thorough smoothing of the roots. Now visibility and accessibility and smoothing of the roots becomes the rationale of gingivectomy, whereas along with this compilation it becomes a complete definition, that is excision of gingiva which provides visibility and accessibility for complete calculus removal and thorough smoothing of roots. This definition is taken from Carenza. It's a pocket elimination technique. Now there are two types of technique, pocket reduction technique and pocket elimination. So it comes under the pocket elimination technique. Robisk in 1884 pioneered this gingivectomy procedure for the first time in 1884. And this you have to remember. Then comes the indications and contraindications. Now this topic is very important from the examination point of view. Mostly in the 15 marks questions, indications and contraindications are asked along with the surgical gingivectomy technique. So here is the table, and in your major textbook only 3 indications and 3 contraindications are given, which are less from the examination point of view. So let's first begin. It is given in the tabular form, and if you remember indications, then you don't have to mug up the contraindications. It's just opposite. Like if there is suprabony pocket, then the infrabony pockets becomes your contraindications, right? If there is sufficient keratinized tissue is present, then inadequate zone of keratinized tissue will become a contraindication. Sufficient keratinized tissue is needed because after gingivectomy, after excision of the gingiva, sufficient amount of tissue should remain over that particular surgical site. That's why initially we will select the case which have good amount of keratinized tissue. If the pocket is greater than 3 mm, of course, 2 to 3 mm pocket is considered as maintainable and normal. Okay, so pocket is greater than 3 mm, but it should not extend beyond the mucogingival junction. You should remember that, because if pocket is beyond the mucogingival junction, then there is less keratinized tissue, so it becomes a contraindicated case. Then if there is horizontal bone loss and osseous surgeries are not required. And in case of osseous reduction, gingivectomy cannot be done, because in gingivectomy procedure we do not expose the bone. So all the cases which need osseous correction should not be taken for gingivectomy. Gingival enlargement for with the firm tissue. Okay, there should be firm tissue. So edematous and inflamed tissue is contraindication for the gingivectomy. Area of limited access. Palatal walls and prominent external oblique ridge. Here we cannot reach and we cannot do the gingivectomy procedure. Unesthetic and irregular topography. By topography we means gingival form, gingival contours. Okay, vertical grooves over the gingiva. So these topography, if this gets disturbed, then the gingivectomy procedure is taken under consideration. Area of aesthetic compromise again is a contraindication. To facilitate restorative dentistry. Restorative dentistry means if any kind of subgingival caries are present, then we will excise the gingival tissue and do the restoration of that particular carie. To facilitate the gingival contours. After anuc and the flap surgeries, actually gingiva loses its form and anatomy. So in order to achieve the same, especially in the aesthetic areas, we need gingivectomy procedure. Next is patient with poor oral hygiene. So it's a contraindication for every kind of periodontal surgeries. Okay, just remember them. It is common. Next we come on to the types of gingivectomy. So once the case is selected, now we will discuss the type of gingivectomy. Most commonly used technique is surgical gingivectomy, then comes gingivectomy by electrosurgery, laser gingivectomy, and lastly gingivectomy by chemosurgery. So in this, surgical gingivectomy is very important. Let's begin with the surgical gingivectomy. Again, it is very important from the examination point of view. Basically, let's discuss some historical aspect. Robisk in 1884 and later Zentler in 1918 described the gingivectomy procedure initially, but the current gingivectomy technique, which is used widely, is given by Goldman in 1951. Now let's begin with the surgical technique. First step is pocket marking. We will go with the diagrams and that will help you to understand it better. First of all, an ordinary periodontal probe is used to identify the bottom of the pocket. Okay, this is the bottom of the pocket, for example, in this case. And when the depth of the pocket has been assessed, an equivalent distance is delineated on the outer aspect of gingiva. The tip of the probe is then turned horizontally, okay, and produce bleeding points at the level of the bottom of the periodontal probe. So that is how. There are three bleeding points we mark. One is mesial, another one is buccal, last one is on the distal aspect. Okay, so these three points will be marked, which are already marked on this figure. Like this, mesial, buccal and distal. Okay, like this. Next is incision. Now here first I have discussed the primary incisions and secondary incisions. The instruments used in primary incisions and secondary incisions, this is important from the viva point of view. Okay, primary incisions can be given with the help of BP blade number 12B or 15, Kirkland knives number 15 and 16. Secondary incision can be given with the help of Orbin knife number 1 and 2 or Weierhog knife number 1 and 2. Weierhog is the modification of the Orbin knife. It has a sawtooth. When the Orbin knife contains sawtooth, then it becomes a Weierhog knife. Okay, let's go on to the second step. After the first step of pocket marking, the second step is incision. In this, the primary incision, basically we are talking about primary incision here, begins just apical to the bleeding points. and it is directed coronally to a point between the base of the pocket and the alveolar crest of the bone. Okay, incision can be continuous like this as shown in figure, or it can be interrupted, for example like this. Okay, incision should be beveled at a 45 degree angle. This incision should be given at 45 degree angle. Okay, this 45 degree angle basically helps in improving the gingival contour. Next is interdental incision. Now the primary incision is given buccally or palatally, and the next incision, secondary incision, is interdental incision. An Orban or Kirkland knife is used to free the tissue interproximally. Knife is again here placed at 45 degree until the tissue gets freed. Once the tissue is freed, it is removed with the help of Hoehn scalers to expose the underlying calculus and granulation tissue. Then, as soon as the tissue is removed, the bleeding starts. So, interproximally, these gauze pieces are packed so that it controls the hemorrhage and bleeding. Next, after controlling the bleeding, all the calculus and granulation tissues are removed, and this probe is used to measure the residual pockets. Then we have to cover the surgical area with the surgical pack. This dressing should be given at the surgical site to protect the area. It should be closely adapted to the site and tucked in the interproximal spaces so that it remains there for 10 to 14 days. Advantages of this technique is predictability, simplicity, ease of pocket elimination, good access, and favorable aesthetic results can be achieved. Disadvantages: healing by secondary intention. Now, healing is again a vast topic to be discussed, but two types of healing are there: healing by primary intention and healing by secondary intention. And healing by secondary intention is little disadvantageous over primary healing. Healing by primary intention. So healing by secondary intention is one of the disadvantages over here. Loss of keratinized tissue, of course, bleeding post-operatively since it's surgical, and inability to treat osseous deformities, of course, because we are not correcting any kind of bone deformities. Now next is healing after surgical gingivectomy. It is important you should know in short about the events which takes place during the healing. First is initial response. Soon after the gingivectomy, wound is covered with the blood clot. So main term here is blood clot, which is further replaced by granulation tissue. Then the activity of epithelial cells. After 12 to 24 hours, epithelial cells migrate over the granulation tissue from the margins of the clot. Okay, their activity starts after 12 to 24 hours, and the activity reaches maximum in 24 to 36 hours. After 5 to 14 days, surface epithelization is completed, and the complete epithelization occurs in 1 month. So these are four time events which you should remember in relation to activity of epithelial cells. Okay. Complete epithelialization takes place in 1 month, and after 5 to 14 days surface epithelialization takes place. That's why we remove the periodontal pack in between 5 to 14 days. Now let's come to the activity of connective tissue cells. In 12 to 24 hours, formation of angioblast and migration of fibroblast occur in the wound area. Vasodilatation and vascularity increases up to 4th day, and it starts decreasing after 4th day. Complete repair takes place in 7 weeks. Okay, so these are 2-3 time events. Fourth is activity of GCF. GCF increases from the first day and diminishes as healing progresses. But it reaches its maximum after 1 week, which coincides with the time of maximum inflammation. Okay. Fifth is pigmentation. In the healed gingiva, pigmentation decreases. Okay. So now the surgical gingivectomy is completed. We have discussed the historical aspect of surgical gingivectomy, technique of surgical gingivectomy, advantages and disadvantages, and healing after surgical gingivectomy. So if the short note is asked, then you should write all these headings. Next, we come on to the gingivectomy by electrosurgery. Now, here we will directly discuss the technique. It is performed basically with the needle electrode assisted by ovoid loop or diamond shaped electrode. Okay, needle electrode is basically used for incising the tissue. Okay, an ovoid or diamond is used for festooning the tissue. For gingivectomy, cutting and coagulating current is used. Cutting is used for incising the tissue. Coagulating current is used to coagulate the blood there only. During reshaping procedures, we will move the electrode in the shaving motion. So this is what is about electrosurgery in short. And you will not get the question separately on gingivectomy by electrosurgery, but you can get the question on electrosurgery techniques. So there you can add this part. Or if you get the types, get the discussion on types of gingivectomy techniques, then also you have to write it. Next, advantages of this is adequate contouring of the tissue, and it controls the hemorrhage because it coagulates the blood. And disadvantages, it cannot be used in the patients with the pacemakers because it interferes with the circuit. When used close to the bone, it can cause irreversible damage to the bone. This is the major disadvantages and the periodontal tissue. That's why we do not use electrocautery or electrosurgical technique commonly. Next is laser gingivectomy. Again, laser is a very big topic, a separate chapter in the books. But here, from the gingivectomy point of view, you can remember carbon dioxide with the wavelength of 10,600 nanometer and neodymium yttrium aluminium garnet, that is NDAG laser, with the wavelength of 1064 nanometer are used particularly for laser gingivectomy. The advantages of laser, of course, there is a bloodless surgical feel post operatively. The no or little pain occurs with laser and no need of injectable aesthetic preoperatively. Can be used in medically and pregnant patients, medically compromised and pregnant patients. The disadvantages of laser is laser beam can cause damage to the operator's eye as well as patient's eye if it is reflected from the blunt surface of the instrument. And the healing healing after laser gingivectomy takes more time as compared to skin. Now the last technique is gingivectomy by chemosurgery. It is not used currently. You just have to remember from the examination point of view that 5% paraformaldehyde or potassium hydroxide are used. Then its disadvantages is depth of action cannot be controlled and so the underlying healthy tissue gets damaged. Gingival remodeling cannot be done because it cannot be used specifically on particular site and it has got very slow healing properties. Now the gingivoplasty. Now gingivoplasty is basically can be done as a part of gingivectomy or can be done independently also. It is basically a reshaping of gingiva. When the gingival topography or anatomy gets disturbed, then we reshape the gingiva to achieve the original form. So it is a reshaping of the gingiva to create physiological gingival contours for the purpose of recontouring the gingiva in the absence of pockets. That is what is gingivoplasty. Indication mainly gingival in cases of gingival cleft, craters like interdental papilla, which is caused after anag, or gingival enlargements where pockets are not present. There we can use the gingivoplasty technique. Technique, it is performed with the help of periodontal knife or scalpel or rotary cores, diamond stones or electrodes. Okay. It is done like festooning of artificial denture, which aims at tapering the gingival margin, thinning the attached gingiva, creating vertical interdental grooves and shaping the interdental papilla. The healed tissue will have thin scalloped architecture that allows the easy passage of food. So this is basically our aim to do the gingivoplasty procedure. Now, this is actually not given directly in the major textbook, but if you add this as a heading in your answers, in your 15 marks answers especially, so then you know, there are chances of scoring some extra marks, because these are not given in many of the textbooks. Wade is a scientist who listed the following reasons of the failures of gingivectomy. Here you don't have to mug up the reasons, you just remember the technique, and if any of these steps go wrong, then it leads to the failure of gingivectomy. So that's how I have listed these failures. First of all, unsuitable case selection. Then incorrect pocket marking, improper incision, failure to remove all the tissue and tags, inadequate removal of calculus and necrotic tissues, papilla tearing or detachment, loose or lost dressings, failure to complete the treatment. If any of these steps go wrong, from the case selection to the surgical technique, then it leads to the failures of gingivectomy. So basically, just remember the steps, and if those steps goes wrong, then they becomes a reason for failure. Okay. So these are the questions which have been asked in relation to this topic. Just go through them, and I think now this topic is prepared from the examination point of view. So all the best. These are the references. Thank you.